Center for the Study of the Constitution and Civic Responsibility, an ongoing inquiry into American political origins and evolving institutions. The executive director of the Virtual Center is Dr. Bill O'Brien. He's also your host for this continuing conversation. Here he is now, Dr. Bill O'Brien.
So thank you, Bob Kincaid, and welcome to a Monday edition of the Virtual Center for the Study of the Constitution and Civic Responsibility. It is the 29th day of June. We have one more day left, and then we will be into the month of July. We'll be into the second half of 2015, which is really unbelievable when you think about it. Welcome to the program. I hope that your weekend was enjoyable. It's been, again, our regular five-day hiatus from the last time we were together on last Wednesday, and of course we know that so much has happened since then on the national and international level. We were into in our last program the Pope's encyclical, and I had mentioned that while we had done quite a bit about the encyclical, we actually hadn't looked at the substance of it in that much depth, and I wanted to do that. I recognize that the Supreme Court handed down a couple of, actually three, momentous decisions at the end of last week. And of course, two of them are getting all the attention, the Affordable Care Act decision on Thursday and the Same-Sex Marriage Act on Friday. And the Fair Housing decision that was rendered on Thursday as well is quite important, but again, it's not getting near the attention that the others are getting. And of course, we've seen ISIS violence, around the world in a series of attacks, which is kind of raising the red flag for the coming 4th of July weekend here in the United States. And and of course, that's always something to worry about. And a number of other issues and things that have happened. It's hard to, we could spend the first hour of our program on Mondays just reviewing the news from the previous 5 days, and I don't want to do that. But again, I do want to thank you for your willingness to tune in to the Virtual Center, as we enter the month of July, of course. On the 11th, we will have completed yet another month of broadcasting here. We'll be heading rapidly towards the idea of 2.5 years of broadcasting, which would be 30 months. I think we'll have, as of July 11th, we'll have completed 29 months of broadcasting here at the Virtual Center, which is unbelievable because there's so much more to do, and there's so much substance and so much depth there. That it seems to me when a substantial amount of time passes, it's occasionally very, very important that we go back and touch on some of the highlights and some of the key bases. I want to do that, when we, perhaps later this week or if necessary into the following week, when we begin to look at some of the most recent Supreme Court decisions in some depth. I know that many of you have been inundated with information and articles and reports and speculation about the significance of the decisions that the court reached last week. One of the things that we've been aware of here at the Virtual Center, I think, over the months and years that we've been on and have been doing this, is that oftentimes when you look at the substance of the dissenting opinions and as well as the majority opinions of the court, and you begin to get into the rationale or the reasoning that the court uses to justify specific decisions in a particular case, that's where you begin to pick up some of the insight and some of the substantive knowledge and insight and information about the operations and the thinking of the court. I have found that while the ultimate decision in terms of what it is important, there's so much more to be mined from many of these court decisions by looking at the substance of the dissent. And of course, if you think back historically, there were a couple of dissenting opinions in the history of the court that have been flagged as key issues. I'm thinking of the Oliver Wendell Holmes decision in the 1890s, and some of the others. But I think you'll recall when we spent so much time here at the Virtual Center on John Marshall and the Marshall Court in the early 19th century, and we looked at some of Marshall's major decisions, McCulloch versus Maryland, and Dartmouth, the Dartmouth College case, and a number of others. And we looked at what Marshall had to say about corporations and their creation in the United States, and the extent to which they ought to be free to function, free of overbearing federal regulation on the one hand, but on the other hand, subject to regulation because they are creatures of the law, creatures of the state, on the other. And that ultimately their creation is to be justified only because at the time it seemed to be in the public interest. So consequently, Marshall's reasoning suggested that in all of these cases, the public interest must always take precedence, if you will, in these decisions. And so often since then, we look at court decisions and we begin to get our priorities a little bit confused sometimes, because, and there's a tendency in our society among many, especially those with leanings to the right, to put the issue of individual rights and contracts ahead of the public interest, of the common good. And Marshall warned us that we can't do that, and I think when we begin to look at that as a barometer in some of the decisions of the court, we begin to recognize some of that. I know that I've already read, spent the better part of the weekend in detail reading the decisions, the dissenting decision and the majority decision in the Affordable Care Act case on Thursday, that was reached on Thursday. The majority opinion of the court, of course, written by Chief Justice Roberts. The dissenting opinion penned by, as we know, by Justice Scalia. And then, of course, Friday, the court came back at us with the same-sex decision, and throughout the weekend, of course, we've seen all sorts of indications as to just how popular that particular decision was. Interestingly enough, not only among liberals and among Democrats, but also among Republicans and conservative Republicans as well. I think that there are political implications of that decision that I think all of us would do well to focus on. Anyway, it is a pleasure to be with you after a 5-day hiatus between programs. I look forward to hearing from you. I would love to hear your views on some of these things. Now, we spent a couple of days last week on the Pope's encyclical Laudato Si, which is praise be to you. And, you know, if you have reactions or comments, I'd love to hear them. I do plan in today's program to pursue that issue even further. I would like to look at the Pope's decision in some substantive way so that we have a clear idea not only of what he did and why what he did is so important, but the organization, the strategy. I want to share with you an op-ed piece that was written in this morning's New York Times, a quite scholarly piece, I thought, which revisited the Pope's decision and made it very clear, now that we've gained a little bit of time since the decision was issued a week ago Thursday. You know, we've had 10 days or so to adjust to the decision and to the reactions to the decision. And we've seen that some of the reactions from the right, from conservatives, have been extremely harsh. And this particular piece in this morning's New York Times made it clear that the Pope was more than ready for that. In fact, he pointed out that there were interests in the Vatican when the encyclical was about to be released that were very concerned about what the Pope was about to say to the world and what the reaction to what he was saying would be. And of course, that those fears were correct. But the point of the piece in this morning's Times suggested that the Pope was more than prepared for this. And in fact, the Pope had written, had embedded within the encyclical itself, defenses and dodges which anticipated some of the criticism he was liable to get, and at least this author believes were successfully able to blunt some of that worst criticism, and so consequently the Pope it was left standing, as it were. The Pope apparently has weathered the initial blast of opposition that he indeed anticipated. And so it's going to be very interesting, it seems, to look at how he did that by examining some of the things he said. So again, I would love to hear from you on some of these issues. I haven't done it for a while, so let me again bring you up to date on my email address if you'd like to communicate directly with me, as well as our phone number, because we had a little bit of difficulty with the phone number last week, but we're back in business today. So if you are inclined to call, we would love to hear from you. Our phone number is area code 304-663-4676. That's 304-663-4676. 4676, of course, on your keypad translates into HORN, H-O-R-N, which, of course, reminds us that we are brought to you on the Head On Radio Network, and we owe a debt of gratitude to Bob Kincaid and his folks for their willingness to keep this program in operation, keep this program running for as long as it's been running. If you'd like to email me directly, one-on-one, I'd love to hear from you. I'll do the very best I can to respond in kind. If you take the time to write me an email, a substantive email, it seems to me if I can, I'll do the very best I can to return thanks to you with a substantive reply. My email address is waobrien906@gmail.com. W-A-O-Brien, O-B-R-I-E-N, 906@gmail.com. And, of course, that's all one word. There's no punctuation, no capitals, all lowercase. W-A-O-Brien, 906@gmail.com. Before getting back into the Pope's encyclical a little bit as the basis for the bulk of our time together today, I'd like to share with you, because I'm guessing that a number of folks tuned in, or those who will be tuned in and when they listen to the program archived on iPods or however else you choose to listen to us. You could go to whiterosesociety.org and pick up our program. They're listed there by date, and thanks to Horst in Taiwan, many of our programs are available on YouTube. If you just go to YouTube and just type in my name, Dr. Bill O'Brien, you will find a number of our archived programs listed there by date, with short one or two sentence summaries of the substance of that particular program, which Horst has been kind enough to include. So there are a number of ways that you can pick up the program, and I know that many people are not able, for work experiences and the time differential and all of that, to participate in the program while we're actually on the air. But I also know that a number of listeners are able to participate, and that's the reason we have the phone number. And again, quickly, 304-663-4676. There was a letter to the editor in today's local paper here in West Virginia, the Charleston Gazette. When I say local paper, I mean our statewide publication. It's printed in our state capital, Charleston, and it's the Gazette, which comes out every morning. And there was a piece in this morning's paper which I just wanted to bring to your attention. I would recommend it if any of you listening have time and would like to check it out. The website is wvgazette.com, WV, West Virginia, WV Gazette, one word, GAZETTE.com. The author of the particular piece in today's paper, dated June 29th, is Joshua Peters. Joshua Peters, the piece tells us at the end, has just recently graduated from West Virginia University with a major in political science. I found that encouraging for a couple of reasons. One is that it's a beautifully written piece by somebody so fresh out of college. I think that's very encouraging. I think it says an awful lot about Joshua Peters and tells us a little bit about the political science program at West Virginia University as well. I think in both cases, I think we can be encouraged. Anyway, the title of Mr. Peters' piece is The War Between Lower Class Workers and Welfare Recipients. It's a very traditional subject, but it's one that is so important that you can't revisit it too often, if that makes sense. It's controversial. It's a particular perspective that a lot of people find uncomfortable, which, of course, is reason, there's reason to revisit it. If it makes people that uncomfortable and it keeps coming up over and over again, then one must conclude that there's something to it, and one must also conclude that it's a very, very important perspective. That it was written by a political science major, I think, is extremely encouraging, because majors in political science are never introduced to this kind of perspective unless they find it on their own. And the fact that Joshua Peters has been has done such what I believe is a masterful job on this particular essay, I thought I would give him credit and at the same time share with you some of the highlights of the piece that he wrote in today's Charleston Gazette. Basically, the theme is one that I think many of you probably already know from the title what it's going to say, The War Between Lower Class Workers and Welfare Recipients. And the of course the theme here is the traditional hostility that seems to exist in society within the poorest within our society. The fact that over and over again we find examples in our history of the working poor aiming their venom and their anger and their frustration, not so much at the people who make the rules, as they do at those people who aren't working at all. The hostility between the working poor and those who are on some sort of public relief. And the reality that oftentimes many of those who do not work at all, who are on some sort of relief, end up doing better and making more on a weekly or monthly basis than do those who work. Many people who work full-time for something near minimum wage, which in West Virginia is not uncommon. It's unfortunately too frequent in this state, and I know some others as well. But those who work a 40-hour week in jobs oftentimes that don't include benefits, that don't cover health care, for example, let alone retirement benefits, that those folks oftentimes end up with more in total than those who are working. And it's a source of bitterness and anger and frustration on the part of the working poor. But the thesis that Peter's asks us to consider, a thesis, by the way, which is what prompts me to raise it here at the virtual center, is that in this particular disagreement between the working poor and the unemployed, both sides are losing. Those who are winning are the ones who aren't even involved in the controversy, but have everything to gain by perpetuating that controversy. And basically, what Mr. Peters points out is that if somebody on public assistance is making more than minimum wage employment would bring, then obviously in the best interest of his family, the most logical decision is to not give up the benefits. And Peters' point is, what's wrong with that decision? It's the one that makes sense. And if working people, the working poor, don't like that, what possible benefit can they gain by seeing the people on public assistance lose or reduce the level of support they receive? That's not where their problem lies. In other words, if I'm working and barely scraping by, even though I'm working full time, by directing my anger and my frustration at those who aren't working at all, benefits me not at all. Obviously, it doesn't benefit them, but it doesn't benefit me. My anger and my frustration, Peters points out, is misdirected. Peter says, every time you turn on the news, you hear another commentary by some rich newscaster who complains about how their tax money is paying for somebody else to do nothing. They're trying to start a war between lower class workers and people on welfare, and they've succeeded with flying colors. Why would they do this? And Peter says, it's simple. While angry working class people are busy complaining about people on welfare, their employers are scaling back benefits, cutting overtime, stopping bonuses, freezing wages, and giving CEOs massive raises and bonuses. It is the business owners of this country, Peter says, who are getting away with whatever they want to because they are able to manipulate people into turning on the unemployed poor. A lot of people don't like to think about that particular perspective. It is, in the minds of many people, inflammatory, because it suggests the issue of class warfare. It suggests the fact that some poor people are being manipulated to take out their frustration and their anger on other poor people. And of course, the obvious answer to that is that if both sides were able to come up for air a little bit and to think about the logic of the situation and would begin to direct their anger and frustration in directions that might be a little bit more appropriate, the results might be a little bit more positive. But that there are clearly interests in society who do everything they can do to make sure that that particular perspective never really surfaces. The one reason I wanted to mention this is because it It is an update of insight that was so significant in this nation 150, 160 years ago prior to the Civil War. Many of you may remember, because we dealt with it here at the Virtual Center some months ago, the publication in 1857, 3 years before President Lincoln's first election. The publication in 1857 by Hinton Helper of his study entitled The Impending Crisis of the South. Helper's argument was aimed particularly at non-slaveholding whites in the South, the poor whites of the South, those who had no direct interest or benefit in defending slavery, but those whose antagonism toward the anti-slave North was being fed and fomented by those who were gaining benefits from the slave system in the South, namely the largest slave owners, proportionally very few in number. Hinton Helper's Impending Crisis of the South was his analysis of the extent to which the institution of slavery itself was keeping the poor in the South poor. And that his point was that if non-slaveholding whites were able to really look seriously at the structure of what was happening, they would begin to realize that protecting slavery was the last thing they really wanted to do if they were looking to do things in their own best interests. Helper's point is that the best thing that the poor whites in the South could do is to join those who are opposed to slavery and find a way to help end it. Because as long as slavery was there, their potential opportunity was limited, if indeed it was not non-existent. Obviously, anti-slavery forces welcomed Hinton Helper's publication out of New York. Obviously, also, Hinton Helper's publication was banned in the South because it raised a perspective that those in power in the pre-Civil War South did not want raised. It's the same perspective that Mr. Peters raises in his essay in today's Charleston Gazette on the working poor as opposed to those on welfare. It basically implies and suggests an appreciation and understanding of the nature of our society in economic terms, and the extent to which many of us find ourselves vulnerable to being manipulated into believing things about the reality of the world around us that are being manufactured primarily to keep us from seeing our own best interests. Again, it's an old theme. It's a theme that I would suggest has come up over and over and over again in American history, namely the struggles between different groups of people at the bottom, and the extent to which things like race and gender and nationality and religion oftentimes pit group against group, whose best interests would be served if they could find ways to work together rather than being antagonistic toward each other. But obviously, there are interests in our society that have everything to gain by making sure that that does not happen, whatever the particular circumstances in whatever particular time you're talking about. I couldn't let this pass, an op-ed piece on the 29th of June, 2015, in the Charleston Gazette, reiterating that theme, which is so important. And I thank Joshua Peters and I thank the Charleston Gazette for bringing it to our attention and not letting that one slip by. I believe it's a very, very important piece, and I recommend it to you. It's in, again, wvgazette.com. It's dated Monday, the 29th of June, and the author is Joshua Peters. I think it's a good job, and I credit him, and I credit the Gazette for running it. It has just turned the bottom of our first hour. It's just 1 minute after the bottom of the hour, 1:31 p.m. in the East. And I'd like to resume or revisit, if you will, Pope Francis's encyclical issued a week ago Thursday, 10 days ago, entitled Laudato Si. Praise be to you. We spent quite a bit of time last week talking about it. And if you'll recall, and I'm just going to mention this briefly because I want to revisit this issue. When we signed off on last Wednesday, we were looking at a perspective which seemed to be very, very important in understanding the full impact of the Pope's encyclical, a perspective which was entitled Holy Ignorance, a perspective which suggests that religious fundamentalism at its core is driven by and based upon what Gary Wills, in a piece in the New York Review of Books, referred to as holy ignorance. And as I recall, in our last program, we had revisited the origin of the term holy ignorance, which is the title of a book written by a French anthropologist 5 or 6 years ago, I believe in 2010. And the author in question, if you'll recall, was Olivier Roy, O-L-I-V-I-E-R, Olivier Roy, R-O-Y, who wrote a book in 2010 entitled Holy Ignorance. Gary Wills, in mid-May, in the New York Review of Books, publishes, in response to the Pope's encyclical and the reactions to it, an essay revisiting the idea introduced by Roy of holy ignorance. And mainly what he's doing is citing conservative reactions to the Pope's encyclical. And Gary Wills gives credit to the French anthropologist, to Roy, for the origins of holy ignorance, and then defines it and quotes Roy on what holy ignorance is and what holy ignorance is not. And what he points out is holy ignorance is much more than not knowing. It's choosing to not know. As Gary Wills says, they summon a courage not to know. Roy says, it is not a failure of intelligence, but a proud refusal to know things tainted by the arrogance of inevitability. Roy writes the following, quote, there is a close link between secularization and religious revivalism. which is not a reaction against secularization, but the product of it. What Waugh is talking about is the emergence, the incredible emergence of fundamentalism in the modern world, not just in the United States, but obviously, given what we're seeing in the Middle East with ISIS, in the world at large. And Waugh's theme, his thesis is that while there is a tendency on the part of many to conclude that this fundamentalism, this emphasis on religious revivalism, is a reaction of the holy against secularization, against cultures and societies that are becoming much more worldly in their list of priorities and much less spiritual. In other words, the world that seems to be being driven by science, by evolution, by the tendency to increasingly cut God out of what makes the world tick. But Waugh's point is, and Waugh is noted, is considered to be one of the world's experts on Islam, on Muslim history and Muslim tradition. And his point is that fundamentalism oftentimes is not a religious reaction against secularism, secularization. Rather, in effect, it's more than a product of it. It's consistent with it. It's a byproduct of it. Because it is built on a sense of frustration and helplessness that drives people not into responding to this hopelessness, but rationalizing it. Rationalizing it by choosing to remain ignorant of it. Refusing to take seriously any of the evidence which science produces. You consequently close your mind to knowledge. There are things that you just don't want to know, and therefore you refuse not only to know it, you refuse even to listen to those who come bearing that information, that research, that truth, that reality. And so profound, Waugh says, is the embedded nature of this holy ignorance that the more proof you bring to these people, the more adamant in their ignorance and hostility they become. The more proof you provide that you are right, the more certain they become that they are. To the point that what they believe, what they want to believe, is not grounded in evidence, it's not grounded in fact. Its foundation, its base, is built upon ignorance, is built upon not knowing. In effect, what they are doing is creating a world of their own imagination. They are providing their own proof, their own evidence. They are building walls to keep out alternative points of view. And whereas the Pope makes the point in his encyclical that 97% of the world's scientists conclude that mankind is responsible for most of the climate change, for most of the warming of the atmosphere and the planet, for most of the melting of the ice caps, for most of the rise in the level of our oceans and lakes. Fundamentalists are much more inclined to listen to the other 3% of the scientists who challenge the 97%, who continue to argue that climate change is just part of a universal phenomenon, that cyclical process that happens in the universe over and over again. So consequently, Waugh makes the point that to these people, one scientific fact from the 3% counts as much, if not more, to them in terms of evidence than 500 of the 97% who insist that climate change is predominantly man-made. In other words, this is more than ignorance. It's chosen ignorance. It's preferring to remain ignorant. And what Waugh points out in his book, Holy Ignorance, is that there's even more to this than meets the eye. Because he points out that in the history of world, in the history of the world, in the history of religion in the world, even though we have looked at Christianity, for example, as a worldwide religion, and we look at Islam as a worldwide religion, these are not religions that are specific to particular nations. We tend to see Christianity as accommodating many nations in many different parts of the world, as we do Hinduism, as we do Islam. Waugh points out that in the history of the world, religion and the emergence of the state of particular cultures, of particular nationalities, have been intricately connected. However, there's a tendency to conclude that these worldwide religions, like Christianity, like Islam, are not linked to particular nations or to particular cultures. Waugh points out that while many people choose to believe that, the fact of the matter is, if you really look at Christianity, if you really look at Islam, if you really look at Hinduism, you begin to realize that even though Christianity in South America is the same Christianity that we find in Europe, in point of fact, Waugh points out, it really isn't. That there's a difference between growing up Catholic in Brazil and growing up Roman Catholic in France or Spain. And that even though we choose not to accept it, the fact is that these traditional religions that we tend to assume are worldwide religions, universal. Remember the Roman Catholic Church, Christianity, as the universal church, the universal power of the medieval church, Roman Catholic Church. Watt points out that in reality, things that met worldwide, there are also many particulars that make it linked to the particular culture and the particular nation state within which the religion is being focused. There's a difference between Catholicism in South America and Catholicism in Europe, for example. There's a difference between Islam on the Arabian Peninsula from Islam in North Africa, or Islam in the refugees population that is rapidly moving into Western and Northern Europe. And that oftentimes these homegrown versions of Christianity or homegrown versions of the Muslim religion, while they pay lip service to their universality, are really linked to the particular cultures, which is a tradition that goes all the way back in world history, Olivier Waugh points out. But the religious revivalism that we're seeing now, the rebirth of fundamentalism in the world now, which is sparked and driven by the increasing secularization of the modern world, is different. Watt points out that this is universal in nature, because secularism, the spread of secularization in the world, is universal in nature. And so consequently, while we tend to look at fundamentalism here within the United States in terms of the way particular churches and particular fundamentalist groups react, for example, to the Supreme Court decision on same-sex marriage this past Friday, for example, the fact of the matter is that the fundamentalism and the revivalism that is at the heart of these particular reactions is part of something much bigger. It's part of a worldwide reaction to and result of the expansion of secularization in the modern world. The more global the economy becomes, the greater the outreach and influence of international corporations, the greater are the economic influences throughout the world of products and behavioral priorities like consumerism, for example. I'm thinking of some of the things that the Pope talks about. It is encyclical. The throwaway society, the consumer-driven society that regardless of what particular nationality we're part of, what particular nation we live in, we're increasingly all part of this secularism, this expansion of capitalism, this emphasis on materialism, and the idea of individualism and self-interest and greed that feeds it. All of that is in its stead promoting among some an expansion also of this retreat or resort to fundamentalism, to religious revivalism, but more important, to the ignorance that drives it. As it grows and becomes stronger and becomes much more of a political force, as well as a religious and social and cultural force, it becomes less and less substantive in terms of what makes it up, and much comprised as more and more of ignorance than anything else. It's a fantastic perspective. Gary Wills points out in his essay in the New York Review of Books on the 17th of May, 2015, if you go online to the newyorkreviewofbooks.com and go to the May 17th edition of the New York Review of Books, you will find this essay by Gary Wills. And he points out that not only is there substance to what Olivier Roy is saying about holy ignorance, but he also points out that there is evidence that has been put together since he wrote, which reinforces exactly what he said. He specifically makes reference to an operation called the Fundamentalism Project, which was a six-year study done in the 1990s by the American Academy of Arts and Sciences with funding from the MacArthur Foundation. That six-year study, entitled the Fundamentalism Project, concluded exactly what Roy says, that fundamentalism is the unwanted child of secularism. The defining, distinctive, structural cause of fundamentalist movements, it reports, is secularization. And Wills points out that this kind of principled ignorance, think of the term principled ignorance, it's ignorance driven by and supported by certainty, by values, by a belief that you are right. Wills points out that this will not be lessened, but will be exacerbated by calling into court more and more scientists to refute it. Since the witnesses enter a court that already has been labeled as godless and is to be resisted as belonging to the forces trying to destroy the real America. The real America is the America which these people, driven by holy ignorance, believe God really intended to create. The real America is an America that believes in the traditional ideas of exceptionalism, believes that the founders were driven to create a nation of Christians, for Christians, by Christians, that is to be governed according to Scripture. And the way they look at the Constitution and the way they look at the Declaration of Independence and the way they look at the founders is to cite and cherry pick every example of evidence they can find of a mention of God or a mention of the divine. A divine, or a mention of providence, divine providence. Whatever they can find to reinforce their view of the real America. I would really suggest, as we move towards the top of this, our first hour, that you think seriously about the fact that this is the America which really, bottom line, is the America that much of the agenda being promoted by the American Legislative Exchange Council, by big money, big corporate money being poured into our election system in order to election delegates who are inclined to believe this, to basically dwell on this idea of ignorance, of the idea that America's number one priority is our freedom as people to believe what we choose to believe and to reject whatever we in turn choose to reject. There is no truth. My truth, my facts are as good as your facts. If you come up with 20 scientists who say one thing, I can come up with a scientist who says something just the opposite. And I am inclined to put more stock in what my scientist says than what your 20 say. And the more proof you bring to the table, and the more people you bring with you with evidence that you are right, the more certain I am that I am. I don't need your information. I don't need your proof. I don't need your research. I don't need your truth. I don't need your facts. I know. I know in my heart what's true. And the evidence that you bring me is coming from people and coming from institutions that are driven by godlessness, by secularization, by conscious efforts to drive God out of our day-to-day lives. And I choose to reject it. And my freedom as an American citizen gives me the right to do that. Will the Pope's encyclical, 184 pages of logic and argument and substantive evidence, convince these people that they are wrong? Not a chance. In fact, what it suggests to these people, as Gary Will says, is that the devil fooled him. The Pope is a wonderful man. He's a wonderful Christian. He loves humanity. He loves God. But he's wrong. The devil conned him. That makes perfect sense to me. I don't need to know anything else. That's all I need to know. The last point that I would raise about Gary Wills, his particular argument, even the Bible itself, which is the source of truth, I don't need to know what it says, chapter and verse. I believe the letter of the Bible 100% is true. I believe that the Bible is the Word of God. As Waugh says, evangelical Protestants follow the Bible to the letter. But a letter freed not only from the original language, but from language itself, in order to see no more than a simple message. It does not question the veracity of the letter of the scriptures, nor is it interested in the actual language of the text, nor, incidentally, in any specific language. True believers have their own language. They talk in tongues. My language is my language. It's the way I understand. It doesn't matter whether you understand me or not. I understand my language. So consequently, even the Bible itself, if you bring chapters and verses within the Bible that contradicts what the holy ignorant claim to believe, their position will be, well, that's not what God really meant to say. I know what the Bible is supposed to say. if you find portions of it that say something else, then I don't need to know that. It's a mistake. So even the source of truth is not truth. It's driven by ignorance. And let me close. We're at the top of the hour, but let me close. Take a minute or two more. Think of our classrooms. Think of the technological revolution in learning in all of our classrooms, in our higher education classrooms as well, of technology, of overhead projectors, of PowerPoint presentations, of slides, of listing of facts on overhead, of bulleted information, a statement of principle or a statement of fact supported by a number of bulleted items which our students are told are the facts which back up the particular introductory statement. Our entire education is reduced to bulleted information, is reduced to snippets of language, devoid of all the rhetoric and all the flowery language that goes with substantive analysis. I don't need the whole story. I don't need the plot. I don't need to read an entire novel. All I need to read is bing, 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 bing. These are the facts. This is all I need to know. This is my truth. And I can repeat it and I can produce it. You just give me the standardized test and I'll respond. And this is not evidence. This is not critical thinking. This is not cognitive analysis. This is not skill building. This is ignorance in the name of education. It is the same kind of ignorance in our classrooms that fundamentalism is producing in our houses of God throughout the world. It is dangerous because it rejects truth. It rejects hard evidence. It rejects the kind of agreements that cultures and languages have accepted as the way to demonstrate proof and convey it. You are rejecting the very substance of what drives the development of our way of life. And you are doing it in the name of God. Into this, the Pope ventured with Laudato Si. I hope that this hour has been successful in suggesting how very, very important the substance of that encyclical is. Because it is evidence raised against ignorance. And what we do with it and where we go with it is to be the key outcome. I think it's incredibly important. I hope I've been able to convince you, at least to some degree, that it is as well. It is 4 minutes after the hour. We've gone beyond the top of our first hour. We have one full hour to go. I'd like to pause and take a five-minute break and catch my breath a little bit, and then come back and get back into this this issue of the Pope's encyclical again. And more specifically, I'd like to begin our second hour by sharing with you the op-ed piece that's in today's New York Times on the Pope's encyclical. During our break, if you happen to be, sitting at a computer and you want to look at today's New York Times, nytimes.com, on the front page, look under opinion, and you will see in the opinion pages, the particular article that I'm referring to. The author is Paul Vallely, V-A-L-L-E-L-Y, and the title of the piece is The Pope's Ecological Vow. We'll look at this when we come back after our break. You're listening to the Virtual Center for the Study of the Constitution and Civic Responsibility. This is Bill O'Brien. We'll pause for a short break, and then we'll be right back. Please stay with us. Thank you, Bob Kincaid, and welcome to our second hour here at the Virtual Center for the Study of the Constitution and Civic Responsibility. How many times have you heard the expression, that's a tough act to follow? I don't mean the first hour, I mean the music. It's a good thing the music didn't lead into the program at the front end, or we might not have had the second hour. But anyway, welcome if you've been with us and stayed with us from the very beginning of our program today. I want to thank you for doing that. And if you are just joining us, welcome to the Virtual Center for the Study of the Constitution and Civic Responsibility. We've been looking at the Pope's encyclical. We will continue to look at that in this hour, and probably for a goodly portion of tomorrow's program as well. We will be getting into the most recent Supreme Court decisions in some depth. Probably looking at Wednesday, and probably into the following week, because as I mentioned at the outset of our first hour, I believe oftentimes that there's as much, if not more, to be learned sometimes in the rationale that the court uses in order to defend or support its particular opinions than is to be learned by the decision itself. Although I don't think that there's any question that the impact of the decisions reached last Thursday and last Friday are in any way insignificant. They are huge. You know, I think if you've looked at the parades and the celebrations that have gone on after Friday's same-sex marriage decision by the Supreme Court, I think you will agree that the impact of that particular decision is profound. But again, I think that there's something to learn by looking at the way Justice Kennedy, in his majority opinion, justified that particular decision. I think there's also something to be said in terms of encouragement, for the fact that so many are, except for the few diehards, and I think we have those on every issue. But I think there seems to be a level of acceptance and inevitability to the court's decisions in these particular issues, which suggest that the arena of continued battle in these areas is going to be fought elsewhere. I think the court has spoken at the end of last week, as many people hoped it would speak, and maybe has put to rest at least some of the animosity surrounding the different sides, as we anticipated and waited. And again, I just want to mention one thing. Well, it's right on the tip of my tongue. I kind of wandered into this here, and I feel like I need to say it. I think it is very important that we didn't know how the court would come down in either of these cases. In other words, there was a level of uncertainty on both sides, on all sides. And the fact that the court could go this way or could go that way on these tremendously important issues, I think is very significant. I think and as we get into these decisions, I think you'll see that reflected more and more. I think that's a major consideration in looking at the role of the court and in looking at these decisions, is namely the political, social, and economic implications of these particular decisions. Anyway, welcome to a second hour at the Virtual Center. I invite you to participate actively in our program by picking up the phone and giving us a call. I would love to hear from you, but more important, so would our other listeners as well. Our phone number is area code 304-663-4676. 304-663-4676. My email address, waobrien906@gmail.com. waobrien, O-B-R-I-E-N, 906, all lowercase, one word, no punctuation, @gmail.com. We were looking in our first hour. We spent the bulk of the time looking at the encyclical from the perspective of the idea introduced by Olivier Roy, the French anthropologist, and picked up in this past May in an article, a review of Roy's book in the New York Review of Books by Gary Wills. The title of the book, of course, is Holy Ignorance, and we were looking at the issue of holy ignorance in terms of what it meant in terms of the world's expansion, the growth of fundamentalism, and the fact that it is consistent with and complementary to the expansion of secularization in our society. And I think what Roy and Wills both ask us to recognize is that the result is not a reaction against the other, but in fact they are codependent, interdependent on each other. As secularism expands, so also does this idea of what they refer to as holy ignorance. At the outset of our first hour, I mentioned an op-ed piece that is in today's New York Times. And I mentioned, and I want to reiterate, that I think the significance of this piece on the Pope's encyclical is that it comes 10 days after the publication of the encyclical. Actually, as you'll recall, it comes several days after that, because, as you know, the Pope's encyclical was leaked on Monday of last week, 3 days before it was scheduled to be officially released. But the official release, the official publication date, was a week ago Thursday. So since then, it has been 10 days. But it's been a full 2 weeks since the world knew what the encyclical was going to say because of its early release. Ostensibly, meant, we suspect, by those that were trying to blunt the impact of what the Pope was going to say by releasing it early before the Vatican was ready. But what makes today's piece in the New York Times, I think, significant is that it comes 10 days after the release of the document. And it is not, in other words, it's not a piece that is laden with emotion and initial reaction to the document as it is first being unveiled. Rather, it comes after most of the most vehement reaction in favor of or in opposition to the encyclical has been released. In other words, the emotions have kind of calmed down a little bit during the intervening 10-day, two-week period. And now it's possible to take a rather dispassionate, objective, realistic assessment of the Pope's encyclical without all the initial hype of both supporters and opponents. The author of this particular piece is Paul Valelli, V-A-L-L-E-L-Y. At the end of the article, there it mentions that Paul Valelli is visiting professor of public ethics at the University of Chester and the author of a forthcoming book on Pope Francis entitled The Struggle for the Soul of Catholicism. This particular piece Vallely entitles The Pope's Ecological Vow. And what Vallely does at the outset is assess reaction to the Pope's encyclical during the first days of it, after its release. And it points out the reality of the incredible conservative reaction against what the Pope had to say. We talked about that in our first hour. We were talking about this idea of expansion of what Gary Wills and Olivier Roy called holy ignorance. The point that Vallely makes is that Vatican sources close to the Pope were worried about the Pope's encyclical because of the conservative reaction that would be launched against it. But now Vallely says the Pope was rather unfazed. And in fact, the Pope remains unfazed despite the onslaught of criticism that his encyclical produced. What Vallely concludes is that the Pope wrote the encyclical fully aware that the reaction against it was going to be powerful and was going to be loud, but that looking back and looking more carefully at the encyclical itself, Vallely concludes that the Pope not only anticipated some of the attacks, some of the negative reaction, but he accounted for it. He addressed it within the encyclical itself. In other words, Vallely makes the point that the encyclical was brilliantly drafted by the Pope. And that when you look at the reaction to the encyclical, which the Pope clearly expected, now that it's dissipated, now that the brunt of the reaction has already happened, Vallely points out that it becomes clear to him as to just how brilliant this particular encyclical is, how politically sensitive and astute the Pope has become. And he makes a point in this context that I think is telling. Many of you will remember Pope Francis's initial encyclical, the encyclical that was released, I'm going to say last year, that was entitled Evangelii Gaudium. The Pope's encyclical, which was designed to renew evangelism within Christianity. And in that encyclical, we didn't cover it, like go all the way through it as we will with this one. But we spent some time on Evangelii Gaudium, talked about its intent. But the fact of the matter is, I think all of us can appreciate that the impact of that encyclical on the world has not been very pronounced. Most of us would be hard put to find places where the encyclical seemed to have any impact at all. You may recall, I do, that critics of that encyclical attacked it because of its criticism of capitalism, its criticism of worldliness, its criticism of secularization, and its call for a spiritual response. Most specifically, critics of the first Francis encyclical, Evangelii Gaudium, termed it Marxist. And we know that when you label something Marxist, or you label somebody Marxist, or you even label a particular point of view Marxist, then you effectively plant the kiss of death on the cheek of substance. Because when the general population associates the term Marxist with a particular document, that causes them to read it in a particular light. More important, it causes them to read it with prejudice, whether that prejudice is positive or negative. It causes those who would read the document itself to look for evidences of Marxism in it. And if they are there, and if you are an opponent of Marxism, then finding two or three examples of Marxism within the document confirms its Marxist leanings, its Marxism, and therefore justifies you writing it off as insignificant because you have found evidence that indeed it is Marxist. And therefore, knowing what you know and believing what you believe about Marxism, you feel completely justified in ignoring the substance of the particular piece in question. So when opponents were able to label the Pope's encyclical Evangelii Gaudium as Marxist, they effectively killed its significance, at least reduced that significance, to the point that few of us can really remember what's in it. Even if we looked at it, even if we read articles about what was in it, its impact on the Catholic world, its impact on the Christian world, has been rather insignificant since it was issued some time ago. In this morning's New York Times, Paul Vallely makes the point that the current encyclical, Laudato Si, does not make any of those mistakes. That it's obvious, Vallely points out, that the Pope learned from the first time, and he was able to embed specific elements within this particular encyclical which made it possible to counter and blunt that criticism. It's hard to label this one Marxist when the Pope's overall theme is to introduce the issues of morality and ethics into the institutional questions associated with the development of and expansion of international global capitalism. When the Pope talks about the throwaway society, the throwaway culture, when the Pope talks about our planet as resembling a pile of filth, when the Pope takes on a number of other issues in this encyclical associated with what we are doing to the planet, what is happening to climate and all the rest of it, he makes it a little bit difficult for us to write it off, because he's not grounding it in Marxist ideology. He's grounding it in Christian ethics and morality. By introducing the moral question, the moral dimension, into considerations related to markets and consumerism and commerce and global trade agreements and the interrelations between the developed world and the not developed world, the relations between the developed northern hemisphere and the relatively undeveloped southern hemisphere. He does it in the kind of moral terms that make it very difficult to write him off by labeling him anything. Vallely's conclusion, he really learned from the first time around. He might have subjected himself to being overlooked and ignored the first time, but it was unlikely that he would make that same mistake again. And in fact, Vallely says, he clearly did not. He grounded his presentation by extensively quoting previous popes, many of them favorites of the conservative movement that would most likely object to what he's saying. He mentions extensively two of the favorite popes of American conservatives, John Paul II and the most previous pope, Benedict XVI. He incorporates comments on climate and damage to the environment from Bartholomew of the Eastern Orthodox Church. He grounds his perspective for the entire encyclical in the life and writings of Francis of Assisi. Francis of Assisi, of course, is known for his willingness to take on a life of poverty and to work within the poor, to work with the poor, not to hold himself up in a monastery somewhere and spend his time interacting with a merciful God through prayer. Francis of Assisi is out there on the roads and highways of the world, interacting with the poor, expressing love for the poor, preaching peace, and preaching peaceful existence within nature, coexistence with nature. It's very difficult to attack the encyclical, Vallely points out, when to do so would require that you attack St. Francis of Assisi, that you attack John Paul II and Benedict XVI. when you attack the patriarch of the Eastern Orthodox Church. Pope Francis has brilliantly incorporated these individuals and these resources into his encyclical and made it very difficult for those who would attack him to do so, especially after he was able to successfully introduce the moral dimension into the equation. Whereas the first encyclical, Evangelii Gaudium, could be seen as a Marxist presentation written to criticize free enterprise capitalism. This one is an encyclical aimed at affecting the hearts and souls of citizens around the world. Its aim is not to politically persuade. Its aim is to cause human reflection and changes in human behavior and human attitude. It's hard to label those things as anything but human. Valetti does something else in his op-ed piece this morning related to the Pope's encyclical. And that is, he points out that the most profoundly influential, even subversive aspect of this encyclical is not what he says about the environment. It's what he says about the mentality of the contemporary world view or humanity that produces the impact on the environment that he writes about. In other words, Valelli points out, argues, that this encyclical is not so much an environmental document as it is a criticism of something more important, something deeper, that is producing it. And I want to quote him on this particular issue. The real problem, Valelli says, is the myopic mentality that has failed to address climate change to date. Myopic mentality. Holy ignorance. Choosing not to know. The rich world's indifference to the despoilation of the environment in pursuit of short-term economic gain is rooted in a wider problem, Valelli says. Market economics has taught us that the world is a resource to be manipulated for our gain, unquote. This, he points out, is really the substance of the Pope's message in Laudato Si. It's not the environment per se. It's the malaise, the attitudinal frame of mind, which makes this damage to climate and damage to the environment even possible. It is the belief, he calls it the myopic belief. In other words, the narrow perspective, which leads us to believe that the planet is a commodity that everything in it and on it are commodities to be exploited. It is a myopic view fed by the assumption that technology, which is producing the problem, also holds out the promise of producing the solutions to it. We don't have to worry about what we're doing. All we need to do is keep doing it, and eventually we'll come upon scientific advances, progress, which will resolve the mess we're creating. We believe that. Most importantly, we're susceptible to that because many of the most influential, outspoken sources have a vested interest in promoting that agenda. That's what we're hearing over and over and over again. Technological advance and science can solve the very problem that we worry about it creating. Consequently, Vallely points out, Pope Francis is able to point to things that we identify as solutions and point out how myopic they are. The throwaway culture. The Pope points out that the throwaway culture has become so embedded in our psyche that we've gone way beyond talking about throwing away things, and we've descended all the way to throwing away people, unwanted people, useless people, the poor, the elderly, the unborn. All of these are reduced to commodity that we can easily do without. We always emphasize, and this is Vallely's argument, that capitalism makes choices available. But the Pope points out that capitalism doesn't do a whole lot to inform us which choices to pick, or which are the right ones. We're being told which ones to pick. But we're not being educated enough to recognize why we ought to pick the ones we ought to pick. And so consequently, what the Pope's encyclical effectively does, Vallely says, is point out that the system which is driving the problems doesn't seem to include the solutions to those problems that the world must focus upon, that the world must address. When you apply the moral question to what we're doing, Vallely seems to be saying, you begin to appreciate the subversive, powerful nature of this encyclical. Because once you apply the moral question, the moral dimension, to what we're doing, once you raise the issue of what we're doing is doing to people, to large numbers of people, to the poor and the helpless, then you begin to introduce problems into the equation that the system doesn't have answers for. And the fact of the matter is, that's the Pope's agenda. In this context, then, you'll recall when we talked about this last week, we talked about the one paragraph in the encyclical where the Pope raises serious questions about carbon credits and how many people, primarily in our country, who would, we would think, buy into the Pope's encyclical, are confounded and confused by the issue of carbon credits, because that's the solution that our nation, the Environmental Protection Agency, the EPA, President Obama in our nation, and some of the other developed nations have adopted the same thing towards reducing carbon emissions into the atmosphere, namely by awarding carbon credits and allowing these things to be exchanged as commodities, almost as currency, so that nations that can't meet targets for reducing pollution can buy credits from those who have been able to limit their emissions. You'll recall that the Pope made the point that sometimes, oftentimes, these are negatives because they seem to be solutions, but they really aren't getting at the essence of the problem. They allow the problem to continue while at the same time you can point to carbon credits and say, see, we're doing something to limit or minimize or even reduce pollution. Vallely points out that he believes the Pope is right on this. Vallely says, technological solutions just change the problem without truly solving the problem. This is the Pope's position. And whereas his critics have pointed out that gas from fracking is less polluting than burning coal, the Pope says that carbon trading may just encourage more speculation and continued overconsumption. It doesn't really address the problem. It's a limited solution within a very limited, confined framework. And I want to read this paragraph from Vallely's argument, because I think it's the key paragraph in his entire piece. In all of this, Vallely says, the market has tricked us into confusing technological advance with progress. It has reduced our politics to a maximization of our individual freedom and choice. We have forgotten the common good, as we have our own common home, the earth. In other words, our prejudices, our mindset, is defining for us the acceptable choices. Excuse me. Banged into my microphone here. The system is defining its own solutions to the problem it creates. And theoretically, we are given free choice among those solutions. But the system is not making visible to us choices which would really begin to get at the problem. That's what the Pope does in his encyclical. That's why the Pope's encyclical is so powerful and so potentially subversive, because it forces us to go into areas. It forces us outside the box. It forces us to think outside the parameters of the acceptable. And by definition, that scares many people and many interests whose self-interest is to be preserved by everybody continuing to function within the box. The Pope is driving us outside the box. He is, in a sense, erasing the lines around the box and giving us free rein into looking at other potential choices we might have once you issue, or excuse me, once you introduce the issue of morality and ethics into the equation. Once you do that, you drive people outside the box, so to speak, if that makes sense. To quote the Pope, Vallelli says, the Pope asks every person living on this planet to stand before God or our own consciences and be honest with ourselves about the consumerist lifestyle to which so many of us are in thrall. Vallelli continues, Francis knows that if the consciences of ordinary Catholics can be pricked, they may begin to adjust their life choices, and that could create pressure for political action. Vallelli concludes that the skeptics of climate change might find that they have met their match in Pope Francis I. I think that this is an important essay. I think it speaks to the importance of the encyclical. I think it speaks to the importance of the Pope's message. And it gives us valid reason to begin to look substantively and meaningfully at what he says. I'll be honest with you, I'm looking forward to the next couple, at least tomorrow, in our program tomorrow. A reminder, by the way, that our program on Tuesday begins 1/2 hour later. We'll be beginning in the East here at 1:30 tomorrow rather than our regular 1 o'clock starting time. We always do that on Tuesdays. So our program on Tuesday will be 90 minutes rather than the full 120 minutes which we have today and that we'll have on Wednesday. But I believe that looking at what the Pope says and how he frames it, how he says it, given some of the perspectives we've looked at about the critics and the idea of chosen willful ignorance that many of them bring to the table when we talk about climate change and when we talk about damage to the environment and to climate. I think Vallelli has given us a perspective on the Pope's encyclical, which I think all of us need to take very seriously. So again, I'm looking forward to being able to look at some of the substance and some of the content that the Pope shares with us. And in preparation for this, I have organized the encyclical around some themes which I think are critically important. The first one is the issue of work, the dignity of work, the value and the importance of work to the human psyche. This, of course, takes us back to the writings of Richard Sennett and the issues of work and the dignity of work that we looked at in previous weeks. the Pope restores or brings back again that particular issue. And he's pointing out that technology is rendering so many human beings on the earth as useless and unable to connect. And when you look at this issue, the work issue, the unemployment issue, the underemployment issue based on skill deficiencies in today's workplace, and when you accept the fact that man's dignity and sense of self-worth is tied to the issue of work, meaningful work, then you begin to realize that when you introduce that issue into the equation, the moral issue, the ethical issue of what you are doing to people when you render them useless, and when you do serious damage to their self-image and their psyche, you are confronted with challenges and the need to seek solutions to problems that your understanding of the market and consumerism and production and creative destruction, the terms most associated with the expansion of capitalism, these are issues that would never be on the table were it not for something like the Pope's encyclical. So looking at what he says about work is significance. What he says about God's universe, the universe, the world, the planet that God created, how it was designed to work and how man was expected to interact and relate to it. The issue of what the Pope calls the technocratic paradigm, the extent to which technology has framed the point of view that people bring to the table when they look at the climate, when they look at the earth, when they look at the universe. The issue of what the Pope refers to as integral ecology, the interconnectedness of justice and dignity to the choices that we must make in the world. The Pope introduces the concept of the common good. He introduces the idea of a commons, of certain elements, certain parts of the world that belong to everybody in common. And he criticizes the tendency of global capitalism to turn the commons into commodities for sale. He even raises the question of water as being a human right, access to clean drinking water as a human right, rather than a commodity that's bottled for sale and available only to those who can pay the price. For water and air, for heaven's sake. And we go on. So I can't wait to get into some of this stuff tomorrow and probably finish it up on Wednesday. I hope that you'll be with us. We've reached the end of our program today. It's 59 minutes after the hour. I want to thank you for tuning in to the Virtual Center for the Study of the Constitution and Civic Responsibility. Have a wonderful evening. Please be safe. We want to make sure that you're with us another day. This is Bill O'Brien. Thank you so much. Be safe.